Good morning and a very warm welcome to the Zhuhai International Circuit as we prepare for the sprint race, the first of two races today that make up round four of A1GP World Cup of Motorsport. And a little bit of cloud around this morning, but conditions pretty good. It's dry and it's reasonably warm, and we're looking forward to some great racing here, John. A brand new venue for A1GP.
Yes, indeed, and a very exciting lineup on the grid for this sprint race. And on pole position is the bad boy from Malaysia. Michael Ammermuller did a great job in qualifying in the sprint race, took that pole position from Switzerland alongside on the front row of the grid, Switzerland, the dominant nation. Three weekends ago in Malaysia, Neil Yarny up for it again this weekend, and I think he feels, given the opportunity, he can continue his winnings way.
Well, indeed, if they manage to do that, Switzerland could put themselves into a very comfortable position going into the Christmas and New Year break before we go off to New Zealand. They already have an 8-point advantage over Team France. France have only qualified seventh on the grid for this sprint race. And what really struck me about qualifying yesterday, John, was the up and down nature of the two different sessions. We've got two really quite different grids here.
Well, it was inconsistency, and again, of course, having a limited number of new tyres to run, and people wondering whether the new tyre really on its one flying lap was at its best, or whether they had to go hard on it the out lap and try and get the best out of the tyre on the actual flying lap. So it was, let's say, it was unpredictable. And in fact, some of the times that we saw, for example, India, third quickest for the feature race grid, but all the way down in ninth for the sprint race. I spoke to the team this morning and they say, we can't explain it. Other than they say that we know that Narain isn't always quite at his top form in the first of the qualifying segments, but he gets better as the segments go on.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. Team Ireland are similar, but the other way around, because they're third in the qualifying for this race, the sprint race, that's coming up first of all, but they're all the way down in 13th for the feature race. And Adam Carroll said he didn't feel as though he made any mistakes, but they looked at it last night, and apparently the engineers reckon they made a slight change in the way they warmed the tyres up with the tyre blankets, changed the pressures a fraction, and that was probably enough.
Well, I think that's part of the difficulty. People are coming to Zhuhai International Circuit for the first time, A1GP visiting this part of China for the first time. So everybody really is looking at it from, well, scratch it and see what you get. And there's Adam Carroll coming out of the pit lane once again to do another lap, another exploratory lap. They can do this as often as they wish until the pit lane exit is closed. But track conditions today are different to that on qualifying day. Saturday was the best day of the two that we've had running here so far. Now weather conditions, temperatures are lower, track conditions and temperatures are going to be lower as well.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. But for Team Ireland, this could be a very important race indeed, because they've qualified much better for this one than they have for feature. There's no doubt that Adam Carroll will be going for it here. He's in third place on the grid, potential podium already. He's had one of those this season at his first race at Brno in the Czech Republic. But Team Ireland are still looking for their first win. I wonder if we might see Carroll trying to squeeze between the two front row men heading down to the first corner here this time. Well, we'll wait and see. There's Team France, a little disappointing with their qualifying performance, particularly for this sprint race, down in seventh after having set the fastest time on Saturday morning, and they felt they just didn't get the best out of the new tyres.
I mean, I think the story down the pit lane pretty much is the same. People anticipated the lap time as being below 1:20. Well, that went out of the door immediately. We got into Saturday morning running. The best time we've seen overall has been from Germany in qualifying 23:203. Where are the 20s, everybody's asking? Well, track conditions are partly responsible for that. But in fact, many people are suggesting that the track conditions that were the best were in fact for the rookie session on Friday morning. And ever since then, it hasn't come to the teams in the manner that one would expect.
Well, it is interesting. They're all having to learn as we've come here for the very first time, but it looks to be a tremendous venue for A1GP. A lot of enthusiasm here from the locals. Good to see there's quite a lot of people in that big grandstand up on the outside already, and this is early in the morning. We're still building up towards the sprint race, the big event. The feature race comes later on this afternoon. So beginning to see that support here in China, tremendous. Of course, we've had more races in China than we've had anywhere else in the world, because two races last year in Beijing and in Shanghai, and we've been to Shanghai a couple of times now. But here's a man that a lot of eyes are on, John. He's the man who was perhaps the villain of the piece last time out in Malaysia. He's got a chance to be the hero of the piece here this weekend. He's on pole position for the sprint race.
Yes, I mean, Michael Ammermuller, without question, is a very fine race driver, got pole position for sprint race. He's fifth on the third row of the grid for the feature race. But like many drivers and teams, there wasn't that level of consistency. I think Switzerland is the only nation that really found consistency over those four qualifying segments. But Michael Amermuller has got a lot to redeem, because his driving antics in Malaysia really were, in my opinion, not in Michael Amermuller's opinion, because I've already suggested that to him, but certainly in my opinion, and I think the consensus in the pit lane was, we don't know what he was on, but I think he thought he was in the military or something. He was launching himself like a missile at three different cars, but at the same part of the racetrack. Now, he's come here, he's got to get over all that, he's got to prove to everybody in the pit lane that he is the driver of the quality that we believe that he is. Starting from pole position, he's got the best opportunity with this rolling start for the sprint race to take advantage of all the work that Germany did to get that car on the podium. Certainly, it's a very potent, very likely winner of this sprint race.
Yeah, he's got the top spot, he's got pole position. There's the man at the other end of the grid, new driver, David Garza, the Mexican. And in fact, although he's at the back, they're covered by only 2 seconds, the whole grid in this race, and it's even closer for the feature race. There's only 1.4 seconds front to rear, and I think that's pretty much the closest in terms of the whole 22 car grid that we've ever had.
I suspect it is, and it was expected again here in Zhuhai. I mean, just looking, we're looking at Team China, Frankie Cheng, starting on the second row of the grid, fourth position. Further down, one grid behind, you've got Thomas Enger for the Czech Republic. Thomas Enger struggled quite a lot through practice and up to qualifying, then on the third row of the grid for the feature race, down in 13th place. So it's this inconsistency. Teams really scratching the surface and not getting the result that they expected.
Yeah, interesting to see. Well, we'll find out what happens in the races. China, pretty strong though, as you say, for both races, fourth and sixth. Little problem here for France. Pit lane is still open at the moment, but they'll need to sort this out fairly quickly. It's only about 2.5 minutes that the pit lane is still open.
Well, I think they're working around the rear roll bar of that car. I mean, some drivers have chosen to run with the rear roll bar connected, others on occasions disconnected. I mean, normally in wet conditions, you would expect it to be disconnected, but certainly work carried out around the rear of that Team France car, as Oliver Jarvis, Team GBR, came in this morning with. Oliver Jarvis, he was reasonably happy, considering he's on the third row of the grid for the sprint race, a lot happier for the feature race, where he starts alongside Neil Jani and Team Switzerland in that feature race.
Yeah, he's on the front row for that one, but he's on the third row for the sprint race. And I suppose in perfect world, he'd like it the other way around, because you've always got a bit more potential in the feature race. Two pit stops, more time in which to make up places. The sprint race really is just that. It's a short race. 14 laps are due to be run around this 4.3-kilometre, 2.7-mile circuit. You don't have a lot of time in which to make up the places in the sprint race. And there's another driver who needs to make up plenty of places. It's Adrian Zaug for South Africa, a race winner this year. He shared a race victory with Oliver Jarvis at Zandvoort at the start of the season. Zaug won the first race, Jarvis won the second, but he starts all the way back in 14th place on the grid.
Yes, and the people that are really in the meat and veg of this grid, I mean, really from the fifth row back to about the eighth or ninth row, are in the zone that they really are going to have to be very alert indeed. Neil Jani suddenly talking to young Alexandria, can't quite get it all out, but their rookie driver, along with Neil Jani and James Robinson, the engineer who's really brought Switzerland to the fore, and I mean, he's very happy, very confident indeed about his outcome of today. But just, it is the nature of the Zhuhai circuit that has, in a sense, drawn the grid so closely together on the one hand, but it's causing so many people to struggle. While they're strong in one qualifying, they're not so strong in another.
Except, as you say, for that man, Neil Jani, who we were just looking at a moment ago, strong in both. I said to James Robinson this morning, great job done yesterday, and he said it was the driver who did it. It was Jani who pulled out all the stops and had that consistency that most others didn't quite achieve. Well, there's Loic Duvala having made a little change, rather than, as you say, look like they were making a change rather than having a problem, so they've sorted it out. The Netherlands were also still fine-tuning the car on those outlaps, trying to get it right. So they've qualified down in eighth place, so a little bit of work to do for them as well. Welcome back, Thomas Enger, by the way. But let's get down onto the grid. Simon Hill is with Kongfu Cheng of China.
Frankie, great to see you so far up the grid at your home race. It must mean a lot to you starting this far up.
Yeah, it's a pleasure that to represent the Team China and the racing in my homeland. And we are very satisfied with our result from qualifying. And now it's sprint race. Hopefully we can make one even better.
Now, in the free practice, it looked like you were doing some very good times quite late in the sessions when the tyres were perhaps not their best. Must give you a lot of confidence, especially for the feature race, but how are you going to approach this one? Are you going to attack?
Yeah, it's a sprint race. I think the race is only 20 minutes, so we have to take all the opportunity, all competitive provided to us, and we will attack maximum.
Charlie, Frankie, have a great race.
Thank you.
So good performance there from Kong Fu Cheng, Frankie Cheng, and he'll be getting plenty of support, of course, from the grandstands here today.
Oh, indeed he will do. But on saying I'm going to attack maximum, I think a lot of teams are slightly concerned because the nature of this racetrack, it is about stops, acceleration stops. You've got five, in effect, straights where you're up to over 150 miles an hour. At which point you've got to get hard on the brakes, slow the car down, and then back up again to maximum speed. And that's putting a big, big premium, not just on the brakes, but on your braking technique and also on the car setup. Because what happens when a car brakes from high speed down to low speed, it tends to transfer weight from the rear to the front and the back of the car gets light. Lots of drivers and teams, I think more the teams, are concerned that they are saying to their drivers, look, it's the shorter of the two races. Well, there are still points to be won, but bear in mind that we want to do well in the feature race, and the feature race really offers up more opportunity for those teams that maybe didn't get the job done in qualifying as well as they would have liked to make up opportunities come the feature race. So look after your car in the sprint to be good for the feature.
Well, joining our broadcast team here this weekend is Charlie Kimball of the United States, and he's going to interview Thomas Enger.
Thomas, it's great to see you back on here on the A1GP grid. How does it feel to be back in the car?
Well, it obviously feels great. After my accident at the beginning of the year where I had the elbow broken or shattered, it was not easy for me to get back to the car, to this car, to the single-seater car without power steering, car which I haven't driven since February this year in South Africa. But we got pretty well on with the car, with the team, and the grid position, sixth place, is perfect, I would say. Everything else could have been a little bit better, but future race would not be easy to start from P16 or whatever I am.
Absolutely, it's good to be that far up the grid. Being sixth, is it easier on the rolling start? Do you think you can use your experience from rolling starts in the US to make an advantage over the guys who don't have as much experience?
Well, the starts in here are a little bit different than in the US. In the US, I think they're a little bit faster than in here. Here we go in the first gear, 40 k's per hour, and then suddenly everybody accelerates. So it seems like nearly standing start to me compare starts in the US in IndyCar or whatever. But on the other hand, I would probably prefer to stand in P6 on the standing grid in the future race. But on the other hand, in the future race from the back, you can obviously make some more places because of the pit stops and the race is long. So it's hard to judge. For sure, it is great to be in front, and I hope I can finish somewhere in the top six and get some more points for the team.
Well, it's great to see you back, and best of luck for today.
Thank you.
Indeed it is. It's great to have Thomas Enger back, one of the characters of the show and always competitive, and he's qualified, as he says, very well there. Sixth place for this one, so he's got to make that count in the race. Talking about the lack of power steering, of course, they are heavy cars to drive. I had a quick word with Oliver Jarvis. He's driven a Formula One car recently as a result of an award that he won a couple of years ago, and he noted that as well and said when he got to the first corner, he almost completely overdid the steering because he turned in like he would an A1 car. It responded a lot more easily than he expected.
Yes, I think there's a different level of technology and power steering, of course, with the counter downforce that a Grand Prix car generates, you couldn't drive it without it, in effect, and it allows you to do very tricky things with the suspension geometry. But in the case of a GT car, well, that's just physical weight. Car weighs over 1,000 kilograms, big, fat, slick tires on it, and a reasonable amount of downforce. It all generates a lot of load, and in the A1GP car we've got lots of grip as well, and on certain circuits, for example in Malaysia, there was a lot of grip being offered by the racetrack, and here it's much easier for the drivers.
Right, well, let's get back down to the grid. We saw the Irish car of Adam Carroll. We can hear from him now.
Adam, the pretty frantic around your car. Was there some problem out in your formation laps?
No, I was wrong. No, nothing at all. Just making a few little, you know, final setup adjustments. You know, just tweaking in for the race.
You got a good position for this race. Why do you think the difference was so big for a lot of the teams out there yesterday between the sprint and the feature?
I don't really know. We had a very strange situation, really. The first set of tyres was really good, and the pace was good, and it wasn't really a problem to do that lap time. And then I just couldn't get within 6/10 of it again. We think we maybe know what's causing it, and I hope we figured it out, because we need to.
Adam, thanks very much. Have a good race. If we just swing around here, joining us is Neil Yanni. Neil, you two are almost alongside each other in the grid. You've raced together before. It's quite a sharp end of the field up there.
Oh, yeah. Well, we know each other since a long time, so it will be interesting. But, yeah, up front, it could be quite close for the first corner.
Do you think you can have the measure of Michael Amemuller in this rolling start?
Well, I hope so, because that makes the race a lot easier for me. But it's always tough on a rolling start to gain a position, especially if you are second, and to take the pole setter, that's difficult.
The last time Michael Amemuller was in pole position, he crashed on the outlap, on the formation lap, and didn't make it to the start.
Oh, well, so I hope he does it today again.
Neil, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much, Lee. And Neil looks very relaxed, doesn't he? Well, every right to feel relaxed. He's come off the back of two victories in Malaysia, and he's up on the front row here.
Yeah, he's also on the clean side of the racetrack, because for the rolling start for the sprint race, the pole sitter is, well, literally just where this grid girl is standing. That's just the camera view from the onboard camera on Michael Amemuller's car. And you would imagine that Michael Amemuller, when the lights go out for the rolling start, he will try and get from the right of the track over to the left to block Neil Yanni, but at the same time be careful that he doesn't open up the door for Adam Carroll, who's directly behind Germany on the grid, to slide down the inside. And it may well be sliding that they're doing, because down the inside of the racetrack here is going to be a lot dirtier than the racing line. And because the rolling start is quite a long way back from the first corner, it's probably the best part of 500 meters, the cars are going to get up to something like 220 kilometers per hour before they get on the brakes. And with the grid so closely bunched together, every driver in the driver's briefing this morning was advised of the concerns that there is, because you've got a lot of speed before you get on the brakes with a lot of cars in close proximity.
Well, the man who starts from pole is Michael Amemuller of Team Germany, and he's with Simon Hill.
Michael, pole position, fantastic performance for yourself and for Team Germany. Have you taken a start with a rolling start before, though?
Yeah, I'm happy to be first, and it's my first rolling start in the first position. Never done just in karting, but in racing cars it's a bit different. But yeah, I think I always went through with my engineer and with my team manager, and I know what to do, so I think we'll be good.
Now, obviously, it's quite a long run into what is a very tight corner here in Turn 1. Presumably, the approach is to clearly to get there first. If you do happen to find that Yanni's got a better run at you, are you going to try and fight back or just sit there?
Depends how far he is in front of me or where he is. But for sure, I will try to stay first. I think it's normal. But I hope I have a good start, and I don't need to defend my position.
Now, you were mentioning you're perhaps not feeling as well as you have been. Is that going to affect you in this race?
I don't think so. It's not so long race, so I think it should be okay. For the second race will be a bit more difficult because I have a bit of cold and a bit sick. But I think it should be still okay.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
So Michael Amemuller obviously struggling a little bit at the moment, but starting from pole, the adrenaline rush should help him down to that first corner, I should think.
Yes, I mean, he's not the only person that's been suffering. The medical delegate here this weekend's had a real flurry of engineers, mechanics, drivers, everybody who's involved in A1GP running in and out looking for cold cures, and a lot of us to do with, you know, the long travelling from Europe out to Hong Kong and then down here to Zhuhai, also air conditioning, which, you know, a lot of people are getting more affected by than used to be the case. So just a myriad of little teething problems leading up to Christmas. And also there's a couple of ones out there. They are rather precious. And even when there's nothing wrong with them, they'll still want to go to the doctor just to confirm that they're all right.
Yes, that's probably very much the case. We're looking down on the grid still at the moment. Moving slightly further down, we saw France's Loic Duval a moment ago. So he'll start seventh. And starting eighth here is Jeroen Bleeker-Molin. for Team Netherlands, and they had a very strong run in Brno in the Czech Republic earlier this year. There's Rob Wickens of Canada. He's qualified in 10th place for this. This is only his second event in A1GP. He impressed us mightily in Malaysia, and he's also gone well here this weekend. Maybe a little lack of experience hurting him in qualifying yesterday. Maybe that's the case, but even so, I think we can expect to see good things from him as we go through the rest of the day. Let's get back down onto the grid and hear from Jonathan Summerton.
Jonathan, obviously starting on the inside here today for the rolling start. I know in Malaysia you got hung out and stuffed into the gravel a little bit. Do you think you're going to try and stay to the inside and not put yourself in the same sort of trouble?
Yeah, I think so. You know, we learned quite a bit from last time, and I think it should be a good start for us. And, you know, we're back in 11th, but we know the car is quicker than where we are, so I think we should be moving forward.
Obviously, with your feature race qualifying of 7th, you're expecting a good result. Are you going to try and come in when the team calls you in for a pit stop this weekend? I know there was some miscommunication in Malaysia.
Yeah, in Malaysia we had a little bit of a problem with the communication. But, you know, in the feature, yeah, now we've got a new radio put in and everything. I think it should be good.
So it sounds like if you do what the team tells you, you'll be on for a good result?
Yeah, well, you know, it's hard to hear sometimes, and I think we should be good this time.
Awesome. Good luck, John.
Thank you.
Jonathan Summerton and Charlie Kimball joining us this weekend. Charlie, and he is the rookie driver for Team USA, so a little bit of insider knowledge there as well.
Yeah, a little bit of insider dealing going on between the rookie and the prime driver for Team USA, but both very eloquent and both well aware of what's required here this morning for the sprint race, and of course better opportunity in the feature race for Team USA. Certainly Jonathan Summerton is a racer through and through, and there's another driver who is a racer through and through, Emerson Fittipaldi, seat holder along with Sergio Jimenez for Brazil. Emo turned up last night, and I suppose he was delighted, or in fact he was delighted with the results in Brazil in spite of having that small penalty after the race was finished, and looking forward to another stunning drive from Brazil. Further back in the grid, sixth row start in this race, the sprint race, and seventh row, not particularly encouraging for the feature race, but Emerson takes the long view, and he knows that races are not won on the first lap or the first corner.
Absolutely right, and a lot of people who've perhaps got more potential. Here's another one, New Zealand, all the way down in 13th place, and it's not usual to see Johnny Reed that far back on the grid, so maybe we'll see him pushing his way through. And similar really story here for South Africa. Adrian Zaug, one of the top qualifiers this year. He's had more poles certainly than anyone else this year, and yet he's all the way back in 14th place, so he's got plenty of work to do. Let's get back down onto the grid now and hear from Loic Duval.
Yeah, joining me now on the grid, Oliver Jarvis along with Loic Duval. You two are always talking on the grids and on podiums. What do you talk about so much?
Lots of stuff, I'd be telling. We're good friends, we hang about in Japan, so it's nice to be racing together. But when the racing starts, the fun and talking stops.
Tell us about the start that you've got from here today. It's been a tough weekend, but you came back well yesterday.
Yeah, I think qualifying wasn't too bad. The start's going to be very interesting. Heavy braking into turn one. Hopefully Loic will be cautious on the brakes and try not to hit me like I did him in Malaysia. But the aim to get through the first corner and just try to make as many places as possible.
Loic, if the two of you are alongside each other, how friendly will you be then?
I mean, yeah, for sure we are good friends. But, you know, during the race we have to try to do the best for our team first of all. But then we have just to do fair race. You know, it's always better when you can fight and still fair. So Oliver is fair, I know that. But then it's going to be tough on the front.
Before you came onto the grid, there were a few changes going on in your car. What was the problem?
It's still difficult to set up the car here, especially because the track is really dirty. So, I mean, everything you do on the car changes just a bit. So it's quite difficult to find a good setup. So was a bit oversteering this morning. We'll see during the race.
Guys, have a great race.
Thank you.
Good to see Oliver Jarvis and Loic Duval there. Team Great Britain and Team France well represented, and they are close to one another on the grid, with France starting in 7th and Great Britain a couple of places further up in 5th.
Yes, interesting, Loic Duval saying that the track is dirty, but the track isn't dirty. I think the difference is that the track temperature is quite a lot lower now than it was in qualifying on Saturday afternoon, and that has a significant bearing on how the tyre and the car interact with the racetrack, and the work going around the back of the car, I sort of second guess that it might be to do with the rear roll bar. And Loic saying the car was oversteering, it may well have been that they've chosen either to try and adjust the bar, but probably they may well have disconnected it, which will give the car a lot more stability in the rear, especially under acceleration out of some of these low-speed corners, and may also give the car that little bit more stability in the very quick corners. And you do want the car to be unstable in those quick corners, because as you come out of them, you're really immediately on the brakes, and that would then be certainly a handicap.
So looking further down the grid, we saw the blue of Italy, now the yellow of Malaysia, and switching across to the other side, we've got the yellow and green of Australia. Ian Dyke driving for Team Australia once again here, scored a couple of points last time out in Malaysia, but to score points from here, they're going to struggle in the sprint race because they're 18th on the grid and points only down to 10th position. Quick reminder though, points are the same now for both the sprint and feature races, so on offer you've got 15 points for the win in this one and 12 points for second place, so it's still vital to try and get into that top 10 if possible, but in only 14 laps from where Ian Dyke is, that's going to be tough. He's just sitting on the wall at the moment, just trying to get some focus before getting into this one. Indonesia next up on the grid, and Satrio Hemanto, who has raced here at Zhuhai recently, unlike virtually anybody else on the grid, still a little bit disappointed with the way qualifying went in the end. He's ended up in 19th place, but better than at some of the previous events where he's had less experience.
Yes, and I think it is that experience that really hindered him in qualifying. When he was able to go out and do a sequence of laps in the practice sessions, the lap times were there, but the difference is when you go into qualifying, you've had a two-hour gap between the end of practice and going into the first segment of qualifying. Track conditions certainly got warmer, but it's the ability to go out on a set of new tyres and show that kind of natural speed. One lap, four times, very difficult to do.
Let's hear now from Johnny Reid of New Zealand. He's with Lee.
Johnny, you're a lot further back than we'd normally see you. What's been the problem?
We haven't really had too many problems. We had a bit of a problem with the brakes yesterday, and you know, at this circuit here in Zhuhai, it's all about braking, and I couldn't sort of pull the car up in a short distance. So we've got some new parts on the car, and it's all looking positive for the race.
Now, when you won at Brno, you weren't at the right at the front of the grid. Can you do the same again from here?
Anything is possible, and one thing is for sure, I'll never ever give up, and I'll be fighting right to the end, and we're looking to move forward and get some valuable points for sure.
Johnny, thank you.
Thank you.
So still got a smile on his face, that's good to see. Johnny knows he's up against it a little bit here, particularly in the sprint race, because the race is so short. He starts 13th on the grid, but he's keeping a positive attitude. He's a bit further up on the grid for the feature race. He's 10th for that, and with two pit stops, certainly anything is possible in that one.
Yeah, I think a lot of drivers and certainly their teams are looking at the sprint race. If you're in a position to win the race or get a podium, for sure take it. If you're not in that position, just keep your eyes and be alert, because there's going to be a lot of action on the opening lap, particularly into turn one. Come the feature race, if your car's in good condition, and in the case of New Zealand, going to start in the fifth row of the grid, 10th place, Johnny Reid is capable of doing a winning performance in conjunction with good team strategy from Team New Zealand. And really, the race can as easily be won or lost by when you come in for your two mandatory pit stops as it is by what you actually might be doing in the circuit.
Look at that, bit of muscle power from the mechanic going into the harnesses on Michael Amamuller's car.
I tell you what, Michael Amamuller, he's being tightened down. I mean, that really, really is the belt being tightened down. Remember that the hands device, the seat belts also now are a part in the sense of how the hands device is secured by both the helmet but also by the seat belt, and it therefore means you've got to really get those shoulder belts tightened right down. And of course, if you're not tight in a car, you're sort of rolling around in it, it means that you're not part of the car, and therefore you're not going to get the best out of yourself.
I don't think Michael Amamuller could be much more of a part of that car, looking at the way they were leaning on those straps, unless he was actually bolted into it. And he's all set to start from pole position here. And we're going to see whether Amamuller is going to come through and take Germany's first win of the season. They are the defending winners of A1GP World Cup of Motorsport. A fantastic season last year, of course, for Nico Hülkenberg, who proved to be a real star. Now it's Michael Amamuller's opportunity, only his second event in A1GP. Can he put Germany back on the top step of the podium? Well, it couldn't be from a better grid position, that's for sure. Superb qualifying effort from him yesterday, and he will lead them away in just a moment or two from pole position. But Switzerland alongside Neil Jani, looking to score points, looking to extend that series lead. 8 points, the advantage he has at the moment, or Team Switzerland have, and if they can extend that lead going into the break over Christmas and New Year, they will be in pole position themselves, perhaps, to try and take the title. They were runners-up to France in the first season of A1GP. Maybe they can go better in this third season. Adam Kahn getting ready towards the back. All the drivers now beginning to be strapped into the cars. We're about 10 minutes away from the start of the sprint race. So let's confirm the starting order. And this is how it looks. On pole position then, it is Team Germany. It's their fourth pole in A1GP. It's the first pole position that they've earned without Nico Hülkenberg at the wheel of the car. Alongside, on the front row, it's Switzerland. It's their third consecutive front row start for Neil Jani. Ireland have matched their best ever qualifying performance. They're third on the grid. China's matched their best with fourth position. Great Britain lines up in fifth place with the Czech Republic alongside. And then it's Team France and the Netherlands. Jeroen Bleeker-Mollen going from eighth place. India and Canada line up together on row five. Row six, it's the United States and Brazil. On row seven, New Zealand and South Africa, two potential winners, but from a long way back, Portugal and Italy, then Malaysia and Australia. Towards the back now, Indonesia and Lebanon, Pakistan and Mexico brings up the rear of the grid with new driver David Garza. So that's how they line up then. It is very close. As I say, about 2 seconds separating the very front of the grid from the back of the grid. You're just looking at the back of the Mexican car there, and their new driver, David Garza, will be starting his first ever A1GP race. The other driver to be doing that is Eduardo Piscopo for Team Italy. He is in starting in 16th place, so we've got two brand new drivers on the grid here this weekend.
Well, certainly David Garza is going to have the best view of what's going to take place going into turn one, and I think he'd be pretty well advised just to not concern himself about trying to make up too many positions, because I suspect there's going to be some action under braking, if not because of contact, but because of people just not judging that the cars ahead of them are going to be on the brakes and slowing down much more quickly. And if you're still on throttle and you get into that zone where you haven't got distance to slow down, it can only lead to one thing. Let's hope that isn't going to be the case. Let's hope all 22 cars get through turn one cleanly. But there is, I think, a general sort of concern that this is a tough first turn on a brand new circuit.
Yes, it's the potential for cars disappearing off into the gravel is pretty high at the first turn, and maybe one or two of the others, turn four potentially, maybe somebody will make a lunge up into that one. We'll have to wait and see. And there are people up on the banking as well here at Zhuhai, some great vantage points to watch the racing. We've got a big grandstand just opposite the pits, but also vantage points around the track to see a little bit more perhaps of the tight corners and see where the action may develop, where the overtaking action particularly may occur. Looking at the front of the grid, you've got Germany and Switzerland there sitting together on the front row, Ireland and China tucked in behind them. It really is going to be a very open run down to that first corner, flat out acceleration. The power boost will come into play. And John, are we going to see everybody, you reckon, on the power boost on the opening lap from the rolling start?
Yeah, I think, I mean, for sure you're going to see the front two rows taking advantage of it. Beyond that, it's questionable as to whether you're going to get any benefit, because you get drawn up and the vacuum that's going to be, the hole in the air that's going to be created by those cars in front of you. But I would imagine that Germany, but definitely Switzerland, will be on power boost. And it's that kind of insight and information, as Oliver Jarvis plucks a, sort of a stray thread off his balaclava, it's probably just fallen into his eyeline, and it's frustrating and irritating. But there's no doubt that Neil Jani understands how to take advantage of a rolling start. Michael Ammermuller, for the first time in A1GP on the front row of the grid in a rolling start from that pole position, may have many other thoughts in his mind and may not have the presence of mind to use power boost when really he's got the best position to take advantage of it.
Yeah, that's a very good point. He's less experienced, so he may not get the trick quite right. But as you said, he's been through it with his engineer and his team boss and his team manager, and hopefully they've educated him in the ways of getting off well at the rolling start. He said the last rolling start he had as a pole sitter was when he was in karting. Well, he was European karting champion in 2000. That's one of the most senior karting titles you can win anywhere in the world. So he's come through the ranks from a very high level. And there he is, trying to rebuild his career a little bit at the moment after what has been a trying season, which involved an injury at the start of the year. So this really is a huge opportunity for him.
Yes, it is. And he has been given essentially the confidence by Team Germany that as long as he can keep his nose clean here this weekend, and he's got the ability. No one ever questions Michael Ammermuller's ability, but there's been questions about maybe his ability to deal with the pressures and stress, and he has made errors, and that one particularly starting in a GP2 race where he went off on the rolling lap, I mean, that was just almost inexcusable.
Max Velti overlooking things for Team Switzerland, and he can afford a smile at the moment because Switzerland on top of the standings and on the front row here. They'll be on pole position for the feature race later. What a good forerunner form Neil Jani is in at the moment. Absolutely superb stuff from him. He turned 24 years old in the interval between the Malaysian race and this race in Zhuhai, and his career is going extremely well. Let's see, though. Let's see if it all holds together in the early laps particularly, and see if Adam Carroll has something to say about it from the third place on the grid. Jan Lammers there talking to his driver, Jeroen Bleekemolen, as the Netherlands hope to pick up some points here, if at all possible, but they've got a little bit of work to do. They are in eighth place, so they are in the points potentially, but they'll be looking to move up a little further. And here we are on board with the New Zealand car briefly, starting all the way down in 13th position. There's no doubt that Johnny Reid has to go on the attack, but he won't want to bend the car. It is a slightly different approach to the races this year, with the same number of points on offer for both the sprint and feature races. You can go for it a bit more. It's worth it in the sprint race.
Yes, it is. The issue, again, coming back to the closeness of the field generally, 2 seconds covering 22 cars, and the fact that the grid at the rolling start is very much more compacted as it comes up to the start-finish line, the lights will go out, and then the race will be underway. Whereas on the standing start, well, that's the standing start as it would be, for example, for the feature race. The grid is therefore probably about half as long again in real terms as it would be under the rolling start.
Yeah, that's right. So it does get very, very tight in the run towards the first corner. Here we are looking at the Team Ireland car, always beautifully presented, absolutely immaculate. And it is Adam Carroll who is in control of things there. I wonder if they can get their best ever finish. They're close to it, starting matching their best ever qualifying position. India, of course, qualified extremely well for the second race of the day. Not quite so well up on the grid for this one. They're in ninth position. But Naren Kartikeyan's a great racer. Always good on the brakes. Always one of the latest of the breakers as well. So maybe he can turn that to his advantage in this race. And host nation China. Well, we've had a host nation win on home soil. That was Great Britain at the end of season two at Brands Hatch. China are yet to win a race. But what they're really looking for here is a podium finish, perhaps in both races. That would really make them happy. They start fourth on the grid for this sprint race and every chance of doing so. But they're going to have to be aggressive on the opening lap here. I think there'll be a few people pushing. And don't forget, Great Britain is just behind China and keen to get past.
Yes, I think the front three rows are going to be the races right now into turn one. What will happen behind? Well, there will be cars. They'll just fan out as soon as they take the light going out, and that will be then a charge down into turn one. I just keep emphasising that It is so easy to sucker for the rundown. You see a gap, you dive into a gap. Probably two other people have seen the same gap and they're trying to get there at the same time. You've just got to be so aware and alert of what's going on around you. Those in the front, Germany and Switzerland, for them it's relatively straightforward. They've only got to keep an eye on the corner. But they will be the first cars on this 11 car grid that are going to be on the brakes. And the cars that are behind are going to have to anticipate where they would brake rather than use their normal braking zone or braking point if they are to avoid contact with the cars ahead.
Looking from the back of the grid, just rolling our way up towards the front, and this is the view from back there. It's a long way to the front of the grid if you're going to try and make some progress in evenly matched cars. Of course, all these cars are absolutely identical, all powered by the same 3.4 litre V8 engine, 520 brake horsepower normal, and then it's boosted with that power boost button, an extra 30 brake horsepower, 550 brake horsepower, but you can only use that power boost button up to four times in the sprint race.
Yes, and I mean, immediately you're going to see the front two cars, certainly one of those two cars on power boost, and I would imagine that certainly Ireland and China, Great Britain no doubt will do it as well. So they will use the first shot, and what they do is literally as soon as the thing rolls, they push the button, and as long as they don't lift their foot off the throttle, then power boost will stay engaged even though they're pulling gears. But if they come off the throttle even marginally, that disengages the power boost, and then of course they drop that 30 horsepower that they were enjoying the benefit of.
The Ferrari 599 safety car there, ready to go away at the start of the formation lap, and that's only a minute or so away now. There it is, confirmation. The 1 minute board is given, the engines begin to fire up, and now the ground shakes as the V8s rumble into action. These racing V8s, though, revving up to nearly 10,000 revs when they're at their maximum, and you can just feel it almost through the through the picture that we're giving you, that sense of urgency, that sense of energy that's beginning to build here now as we look towards the sprint race, the first ever A1GP race to be held here in Zhuhai in southeast China, close to Hong Kong, close to Macau, a great center, of course, Macau for motor racing over the years, and the Zhuhai circuit now in its 11th year of operation, seeing some of the fastest cars that have ever raced here.
And we're going to see, I think, a pretty exciting sprint race. We're going to see a new lap record, current lap record held by Karan Chandhok, the Indian driver in an Asia V6 Renault. That was in October 06, and that's going to be very quickly shattered indeed.
About to go on the formation lap. The Ferrari pulls away, and the cars are released, and it is Michael Amemuller who leads them away. Seeing Germany on the front row of the grid is not something we're unusual with, but it's a different driver this time because it's Michael Amemuller, not Nico Hülkenberg, who has taken Germany to that top spot on the grid. Now he can see whether he can take his first victory, and that would be quite a performance. It's only his third race in this class. Well, is Amemuller going to be the hero of the day this time as opposed to the villain of the piece last time out in Malaysia? The championship position, Switzerland lead by 8 over France, New Zealand in third. They were leading, remember, after the Czech Republic meeting. Netherlands in fourth place, South Africa in fifth, but they start all the way in 14th place on the grid. Further back, Ireland have a good chance of scoring some points and moving up the order. China as well, down in 10th at the moment, but lined up fourth on the grid here. Germany, of course, all the way down in 11th, the reigning champions, but they've got a huge opportunity to move up with Michael Amemuller starting from pole position. And those yet to score, of course, are looking for chances to do that here today, Lebanon in particular.
Just watching the cars coming through the exit of turn four and then the flick that is turn five. There was unhappiness from a few team managers yesterday that some drivers and nations on the exit of turn four had shortcut across those, what they call their eco-concrete blocks. And there was a marginal time gain by doing so, and I think there would be clarification given to the team managers this morning that that is not permitted. The regulations, I think, are fairly clear on that, but a number of drivers we saw doing it in qualifying in particular.
Well, there's always these anxious moments for the pit crews, for everybody involved in each and every team as we get ready for the start of the race. It's out of their control now. It's down to the drivers to try and sort it all out on the opening lap and try and get into position. No pit stops to be made in this sprint race. There will be pit stops, of course, later in the feature. This one is down to the drivers. Later, the teams can lend their assistance to moving them up the grid and up the results. But here we are on board with New Zealand. The safety car just slowing it all down.
Yes, and it is a very slow approach down to the final turn, then onto the pit start straight. As Thomas Enger said, he's accustomed to rolling starts, but at a higher speed than we're seeing here.
So the cars make their way down to the final corner as we prepare for the start of the sprint race in Zhuhai. It's Germany who will lead from pole position, Switzerland on the outside of the front row, but watch out for Ireland and China starting on the second row of the grid. They are bunched up, they are ready to go. Now we wait for the signal. Wait. Lights go out, away we go, and Germany makes a fantastic start, a really good start on the rolling start for Michael Amemuller. Watch in the background, Great Britain going side by side, trying to get involved. Third place is Ireland, China through, and then Great Britain in a side-by-side battle, but it's clean up front.
Yes, it is. I think it's pretty much clean all the way through. Dust being kicked up on the exit of two, but Germany have got it from Switzerland, coming into turn three, and then now into four, trying to go the long way around Germany, but Switzerland cannot get
South
it
Africa spins right in the middle. There's contact with other cars, bouncing over, Malaysia included, and Lebanon's in the gravel.
And Brazil as well, three cars, four cars involved. That's going to see a red flag, I have to believe, because those cars are stranded in the middle of the exit of turn four. Contact, South Africa got spun around, and then three other cars.
Safety car has been called for. They haven't gone for a red flag yet. They're going to assess it under safety car. It's Germany leading from Switzerland, Ireland, China, with the Czech Republic having moved up. That was the car side by side with Great Britain. And the Czech car is in fourth. Thomas Enger, what a return for Thomas Enger. But look at this, what a shame. Lebanon off, we've got the South African car, the Brazilian and the Australian car all involved, all stuck there in position. It's going to be quite hard for these guys to pick their way past.
I think it would be very difficult. That's why I'm considering looking at Emerson Fittipaldi, Team Brazil, with his car jammed in between South Africa and the Australia car. Lebanon in the gravel trap. Turn four, not a particularly difficult corner. As we look inside the Australia garage, John Martin's father in the garage there, keeping an eye on proceedings. So, flashing yellow light, safety car waiting to pick up the chain of cars. Malaysia also right rear, they were clipped, damage to the rear suspension for Alex Jung.
Oh dear, it doesn't get any better for Malaysia, does it? Everything seems to go against them at the moment. He got caught up in it, and it was, oh look, they've managed to do a fantastic clearance work there to get the cars.
They got by, they managed to pull the cars apart. Yep. Got Ian Dyke started, he's running now, whether his car has got sufficient damage, or he may have just found himself compromised, but there, look, the damage to South Africa and Malaysia, that's a nose and a wing. Damage probably not great, but certainly pit stop. It was Brazil now still stuck there. That's the one car that really has got to get clear.
So they can ease past him.
He did actually get rolling, but then was not able to continue.
So hopefully everyone's going slow enough to pick their way past safely. It was difficult to see exactly how that began. I saw the South African car starting to spin, but he may well have had a touch from somebody else that put him into that spin. And once he was starting to go, of course, there really was no room for the others.
I mean, everybody was so close together, so tightly bunched. And of course, the cars were trying to go two or maybe even three abreast. And there you see nose wings shredded as Brazil now, they're trying to pump start him. Hopefully the Brazil car can get running and get back to the pit. The car itself, to me, looks relatively, in fact, it doesn't look damaged at all. And probably the same effect for Australia. They just find themselves confronted with a car facing the wrong way. That was South Africa's car, Chris Alajajian, in the Lebanese car. I thought you're actually required to get out of the car now before you are hoisted up. But, of course, that car is going to be pulled away to safety. It will not continue in this sprint race with 13 laps to go. And so 15 and a half minutes remaining.
South Africa into the pits for a nose change. Australia carried on round. Malaysia are in for a wheel change after the puncture, so there's work going on here. Now, of course, Brazil...
Malaysia's got suspension damage.
Not just the puncture. OK, well, that's... he's really crawling his way back in. South Africa about... Oh, that doesn't help. Oh, I see. He's letting him through. No, come on, boys, sort it out. There's more problems at the back of the South African car. Now they're looking around the left rear as Malaysia comes to a halt.
Now, you can see that something in the rear suspension has been damaged. And the tire has actually gone down, not because of the damage initially. And Adam Khan as well.
I think that's the Lebanon car.
Yes. So the damage has been to the tire has been caused by the tire rubbing in the bodywork because the alignment of the rear has been so far out.
So South Africa not underway. There's damage to the bodywork around that side pod area. So maybe they aren't going to be able to send him back out. The leaders are just passing us in our commentary box going over the line. There you are, heading down towards turn one. So that has put him a lap down. Poor old Brazil are the ones who lost out a bit there because by stalling it or whatever they did, they've effectively lost the lap. And so they're really never going to get back from there. If you look at the positions, they all have to follow the safety car now, of course. We've got Germany, Switzerland, Ireland, China, Czech Republic. I said Czech Republic fourth, I think, earlier, but they're actually in fifth place behind China, just to clarify that. So China fourth, Czech Republic fifth, then Great Britain, followed by India, France, the Netherlands, and New Zealand. New Zealand gained three places in that opening little scramble, if you like. So Johnny Reid into the points as Brazil does get going. So he had to come into the pits, back out again. Well, he won't score any points, but there's a chance to see how the car handles. Indonesia also there into the pits.
We didn't really see how Indonesia, they must have got tagged somewhere just off camera, but it was Brazil that, they would have lost out that lap regardless of whether the car stalled or not, because he had to come into the pits and check out that there wasn't sufficient damage to the front of the car as Alex Jung disconnects the radio from his helmet. And again, another race of huge disappointment to Alex Jung and to the Malaysian team.
Yeah, it's just not coming together for them for whatever reason. There was nothing they could do there. They were just involved in an instant. But when you qualify quite a long way down, which is what they did, down in 15th place, then you're going to be in the middle of all that. South Africa must have, as I say, maybe he's out of the car now, so no chance for them either.
Well, here's the restart, the run down into turn one. And surprisingly, I think everybody actually got through turn one without any contact.
Yeah, this was the original start, and it's pretty amazing how clean it was. It wasn't at the first corner it went wrong, it was further down, wasn't it?
Yeah, and just looking at Indonesia, I don't know whether they got clipped from behind as they fanned out coming on to sort of the broadest bit of the start-finish straight, but there they are into turn one, and from what we can see, there was no contact at all occurred here, and look for South Africa in the middle of that bunch. It gets spun around, and you have to imagine that was contact.
Here we go, we're back to racing real time now, and Germany gets the jump at the start once again. Switzerland in second, Ireland in third, China in fourth, Great Britain trying to get back at the Czech Republic, side by side almost turning in, but Oliver Jarvis can't make the move on Thomas Enger.
No, Thomas Enger did a good job. He got over to the right-hand side of the racetrack, precluded Great Britain getting through India right up under the rear wing of Team GBR, down into turn four.
Yeah, he's having a little look, but he can't do anything. France is tucked in behind, and then behind, New Zealand involved. Oh, and there might have been, was there a little bit of a tangle with Canada?
Yes, indeed. Well, that may well have been a touch. Certainly, cars having to fan, just simply going through to now turn seven. And again, hard on the brakes into turn eight.
This is hard racing, as we say. And back there, look, Pakistan and USA side by side as well. New Zealand had a go at getting past Netherlands, but now they've lost a place as a result of that, because Rob Wickens of Canada charged through on the outside. There looked to be a little touch, but they both got away with it. Oliver Jarvis for Great Britain. He is running in sixth place, but India in seventh. Remember, India had great pace in qualifying in the second race. They had the potential in the car. Maybe they didn't use that potential in qualifying for this race, and Naren Kartikeyan now trying to make the most of that. Here's another little attack coming further back, but it doesn't quite pay off for Mexico on Australia. Oh, somebody's off.
Well, somebody kicked up a lot of dust on the exit, just dropped the wheel off the curb. I think all the cars stayed on the racetrack, but Michael Ammermüller has taken advantage of that opportunity of starting in pole position and, of course, being the head car at the restart, and has pulled out a slight advantage. He's got just over half a second over Neil Jani for Switzerland, and Adam Carroll for Ireland, a further half second behind Switzerland.
Yeah, Ammermüller was pushing. The car got quite sideways through that last corner, but he held on to it beautifully. Team USA versus Pakistan. Let's see what... And that was the New Zealand-Canada clash. Thought there had been contact, and there certainly was, but Canada still came out ahead.
Yeah, well, Canada seemed to be just to the outside. Yeah, suddenly you'll see the car. There it is. So just track position, two cars trying to get through a corner where really only one ought to be on the racing line.
Good, brave stuff from both drivers. Ammermüller leads for Team Germany. Switzerland in a comfortable second place. Then it's Team Ireland in third, not able to challenge yet. China, Czech Republic, Great Britain, what's happening further back? Australia and Pakistan, with Mexico joining in. This is a good debut by David Garza of Mexico. He's getting really into the action here. He might have qualified at the back as he learns A1GP, but he's certainly not afraid of it. Look at them running out of turn 10, all of them running just over the curb there, kicking up a little bit of dust, and that's a great view from behind as they push to the limit, now up towards turns 11 and 12.
Oh, what a lock-up for New Zealand, almost running into the back of Canada. So Johnny Reid frustrated, having lost that position again, coming out of that turn 7, kicking up the dust, the run all the way down now. So New Zealand still under the rear wing of that Canada car into turn 14. Watch the car. A lot of work on the steering wheel for New Zealand, having to keep the car on the straight and narrow.
Yeah, a bit of oversteer to correct, wasn't there, through that last corner. Germany continues to lead. We're back into turn one. 10 laps to go. There's not much time. You've got to get on with it in the sprint race. Little lock-up from Canada. This could give Johnny Reid the chance heading up to the next corner, but can he get close enough?
Through turn three, no, but all you can do is get under the wing and try and have a lock. Slot down the inside. He's not close enough to go down the inside, because Canada's going to be as late in the brakes as New Zealand is.
Yeah, that's right. And Rob Wickens, the youngster for Canada, who joined the show last time out in Malaysia, has already impressed us and shown us what he is capable of doing. And now up towards turn seven, another heavy braking area, and round into the hairpin he comes. Nothing he can do, and still tracks the wheel marks that Canada leaves.
Well, just sitting there, and it's all about acceleration and braking, and if you cannot get into position, then the best chance is really going to be trying to get out of turn 14 quicker than the car that you're following, and then get up alongside. If you try and make a late shot down the inside, I think it's not going to really work for you.
Germany holding on from Team Switzerland. Those two maybe just easing away fractionally from Ireland, but it doesn't look as though anybody's in quite in the position to attack yet. Further back, you've got Pakistan running just ahead of Australia, then Mexico and Indonesia, and then the Brazilian car, which of course got involved in the incident earlier on.
It is ironically the Brazilian car running in 19th place, and in fact in last place, that has just set the fastest race lap. So Brazil have got that one point that's up for grabs for whoever can set the fastest race lap.
That is interesting. So Sergio Jimenez going very well at the back. He's got clear air, but he's faster than the race leader, who has also got clear air. Germany, who's not actually pulling away much from Team Switzerland. Here's the battle for third, Ireland versus China. What chance for China to get a podium finish here?
Well, Ireland is dropping away from the tail of Switzerland, allowing China to catch up again. The same situation everybody faces will be, where can I get the opportunity? certainly at this part of the racetrack, coming out of turn three into turn four, in these circumstances, it's unlikely. The best chance is going to try and catch Ireland unawares again by a run, a strong run out of turn 14 up into the first turn of the circuit.
Won't be easy. Adam Carroll's a hard and feisty racer for Team Ireland and a great addition to the team this year as he's joined in the fun and games. He's looking for his second podium finish as Kong Fu Cheng, Frankie Cheng here, we're riding on board with him in the Chinese car. He would love to be on the podium. China have had one podium finish in the past, but not with Frankie at the wheel. And not far behind them is Thomas Enger.
Thomas Enger, and also I saw Team GBR, Oliver Jarvis. He also was having a little sneaky look. Not an overtaking manoeuvre, but just checking out to see if he can catch Thomas Enger unawares, because going up into turn 11, it is possible if you can get far enough up before you get to the braking zone.
The first ever A1GP race at Zhuhai is certainly proving entertaining as Michael Amemuller holds the advantage over Switzerland, then a gap back to Ireland, China, the Czech Republic and Great Britain, represented by Oliver Jarvis here this weekend. And he's got Naren Kartikeyan of Team India right behind him, so he can't afford to relax. Then it's Loic Duval of Team France, who had a slightly disappointing run in qualifying, but now is beginning to line up that Indian car for a possible pass.
Yeah, I think Loic Duval feels, and probably rightly so, that he's got the edge and performance over Team India. But of course, he's lined up in a line of cars from China, Czech Republic, Great Britain, India, and all the momentum that he has that he wants to carry forward locks it up. Oh, and that was a big lockup going up into turn seven.
Big mistake, and it's allowed the car behind, which is the Dutch car, Team Netherlands, to close up a little bit. Don't allow Euro and Blue Kamolen too much of a space. He will grab it, that's for sure. Team China still tucked in there, and in the background, I don't think the Dutch car was able to take advantage, but Team France had a little bit of a moment there, yet they're still in the same positions as Germany and Switzerland continue to lead this race.
Germany now has got fastest race lap, having all that clear air allowed Michael Amemuller to do what he needed to do, focus on what was ahead. But watching the cars as they came up into turn 11 and 12, it looked like the gap that was up to almost a second, 0.803 is to be precise. Let's see as they come across the line. Down to half a second, so either Amemuller has lost pace. No, it's not. It's because the fastest lap has now gone to Switzerland. Neil Jani has picked up the pace. He is now the fastest driver on the lap.
He's doing a lovely job, Neil Jani. He's riding such a wave of confidence after those two victories in Malaysia. There he is in the Swiss car, the blue, white and red colours. And he's driving superbly. And even tucked in behind the rear wing of another car, he's able to go quickly, as is Team China there, following Ireland and getting to within a car's length or less. Behind them, it's still Thomas Enger of the Czech Republic, and watch Oliver Jarvis on the attack.
He's going to have a look. Can he get Noe? He's not going to be able to get far enough up going into turn six. But he's got the momentum. Clearly, that start that we saw from the Czech Republic has served Thomas Enger very well. But, of course, equally, he's got that arm, which is not 100%. And he's just hanging on there. If he can hang on to his fifth place and take the points, he'll be more than happy.
He will be delighted. Yeah, that would be a great result for the Czech Republic. Be well pleased with that. They had a tough year last year, didn't really come together. He did win in China at the end of season one, but never really looked like winning anything for the Czech Republic in season two. This is a return for the Czechs up towards the top end of the field, and that's good to see. But Oliver Jarvis of Great Britain potentially, I think, could go quicker, but he's got to find a way past.
Well, what Czech Republic appear to be doing is that they're not so quick into the corners as Team GBR is, but of course GBR overruns to the back of the car. They've got to get off the throttle, and therefore that sort of to and fro motion that we're seeing. So Oliver Jarvis has got to think a little bit more about where his strengths are and how can he take advantage of them.
This could be a timed race, so it's quite close. Five laps to go, or 4 minutes, just under 4 minutes. So it's going to go to time, I would think.
But it's usually 19 minutes plus one lap.
Yeah.
So we've got just under 4 minutes and 3 minutes and 40 seconds plus one lap.
So we'll see how that works out, and watch the counter in the top left of the screen. And if that switches to time, then you know it's going to be a timeout race. Whatever, they don't have a lot of time left. That's the one it comes down to. They've got to get on with it if they want to make any more progress through the field. And Team India again closing up towards the back of the British car as the Czech Republic just sort of holds them off for now. That's what Thomas Enger's concentrating on, and he's very skilled at that art. He won't let them come through very easily, and that's fair enough. He's fighting for the honour of his nation, and he wants to try and keep them behind at the moment. Now, Team China running in fourth place. Let's tap into a bit of their radio communication. Oh, we're just trying to catch into that. We didn't quite get it. We'll try and pick that up next time. Not quite there. We'll try and come back to some of that radio communications that we are monitoring throughout the course of this race.
And Frankie Cheng was on power boost coming down into turn 14, trying once again to get into position to take a challenge to Team Ireland. Come across the line, the gap was 0.3 seconds, and Frankie Cheng shows the nose of the car to Team Ireland, Adam Carroll, just to make sure that Adam Carroll's checking his mirrors. And that's what you want to do if you can get a driver looking in the mirrors one way and the other. Coming through turn three, the flat out right hander now goes to have a go down the inside. He's got a long side, he's taken the position away.
China into third place on home turf, managed to do it. What a great move by Kung Fu Cheng. Frankie's done it, he's got past Adam Carroll, one of the hardest races in the business. But here comes Ireland coming back at him, trying to retake that place. Frankie's having none of it.
Well, I tell you, that was such an aggressive move from left to right from China to defend. How Adam Carroll managed to avoid the China Cup, I will not know. But suddenly Adam Carroll has realised, I want to be in the podium. I want that third place. I want to take it back.
Well, China in with a chance here of taking podium on home turf. What a fantastic result that could be for Frankie and for the whole team here at Zhuhai for the first time. Up front, by the way, Germany and Switzerland, still nothing between them. Switzerland are relentlessly keeping the pressure on Michael Amermuller, who's seeking his first ever win, and to back up the victories that Germany enjoyed in season two on their way to the title. So there's still action to come. Let's see what happened. New Zealand's just made a move.
Contact with Canada. Well, is that a payback? No, I don't think so. Turn one was never on. The front wheel of New Zealand was only level with the rear wheel of Canada, and that was down to Johnny Reid in this occasion.
Another sprint race and another knock for Team Canada. Oh, and a spinner in the background, I think, has hit the wall. Is that the Indonesian? No, it's the Portuguese car.
It is, and that's the first time we've seen a car spin up on the exit of turn 14. We always knew problematic corner, but that's a big old shot. Joanna Berno, you can see his frustration, but look what's going on behind. France trying to find a way past India. Oliver Jarvis has now got ahead of that India car.
Oh, and India a bit sideways. This could deliver an opportunity for Duval, who's going to go side by side. Is he? No, he can't do it through that flat out gink. And is he going to have a run? Oh, Inare Kartikeyan shuts the door, but he might break too late. They all lock up the brakes, still make it round.
And the Netherlands was the one that was potentially in position to pick up the pieces. Had that all gone wrong going into turn six.
Great stuff. This is what we expected. It was always going to be frantic and fraught to get past here, but there are opportunities if you're brave, and that's what China was. That's what Kung Fu Cheng, Frankie Cheng, managed to take third place. The move of the race, no doubt about it. Fantastic piece of overtaking. Up front, though, it's looking good for Germany and for Switzerland. They'll come round this time and have one more lap to go, by the looks of things. And that, we've got the yellow flags. This is where Jean Urbano has gone off on the exit of the last corner. They'll go past the stricken car, there it is, and then one lap to go. We're on to the final lap now, and Amermuller surely heading for victory.
Yes, I mean, he's got the race totally in control. The gap's down to, again, 0.7 seconds, the fastest race lap gone back to Switzerland, so Neil Jani has not given that up. But the reality is, unless something goes wrong for Germany, that the positions are going to be Germany, Switzerland and China with that outstanding manoeuvre. That was all done on the exit of turn two. He got a better run off turn two and had the momentum as it went through three, got alongside Ireland into turn four, and that was the position confirmed.
On board with Team Switzerland, Neil Jani's driven a beautiful race. He's kept the pressure on the German driver, and that's really what he needed to do. He knows that Michael Amermuller's season has been a poor one, and maybe he would be prone to make a mistake if he could just keep the pressure on. But you can tell Neil Jani also wasn't going to take a big gamble in trying to get past him. Well-judged race by the series leaders. It looks like they're going to be in second position, but Germany are going to get their campaign back on track here.
Yeah, I think the thing that Neil Jani and Switzerland decided, we aren't going to get the lead of this race, but what is important is to get the fastest lap, and that's what Switzerland have done. They did it on lap 11.
Yeah, clever stuff. Further back, just inside the top 10, New Zealand, with Canada out of it now, dropping down to 15th place as a result of that contact between the two of them. France running in 8th place, but here we do come down to the final corner, and it is going to be victory for the new driver for Germany. Michael Amermuller takes the win here at Zhuhai in China. 2nd place goes to series leader Switzerland, and 3rd goes to China, the host nation. A fantastic podium, and he earned that. He fought his way past Team Ireland. What a star drive there by Kung Fu Cheng. He takes 3rd place. Look at the reaction down there on the pit wall for the Chinese team. This will mean the world to them.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that was a very well thought out and executed overtaking manoeuvre. We've seen a lot of attempts from a lot of drivers, a lot of them with more experience. But Frankie Chang got the run out of turn two. He had the speed off the corner, had the traction, and then he used it perfectly. And then coming into turn four, he was alongside Ireland before they got into the braking zones. And once you're in that position, there was nothing Adam Carroll and Team Ireland were able to do to respond.
And a quick note, China matched their best ever finish, but it's Frankie's own first podium, because it was Ho Pin Tung who took their first podium. But it's Frankie's first, and that is going to be so special. Team Switzerland have lots of smiles too, because that second place meant a lot. This is what happened to Portugal.
Yeah, it just got away from them, and really, oh, that was a very big old impact, because the car did not slow down as much as one would have anticipated going sideways across the racetrack. Damage is superficial, but nevertheless, it's more damage that's going to be repaired all down the left side, the nose, the rear wings. And Joan Navarro clearly frustrated and upset by that, but that was just quite simply a driving error and, well, a little bit of inexperience.
Yeah, he did exactly the same as Zandvoort, I seem to remember as well, a similar sort of accident. So great shame for Joan Navarro. But it's Germany that have taken the victory, and that is their 10th win in A1GP. But up to now, all the winning has been done by a certain Nico Hülkenberg. Well, the Hulk has been replaced by the Hammer, and it's Michael Ammermüller who has taken victory. And he's starting in fifth place for the feature race later on today. That will be a little bit more of a tall order for him to take the win. This is a look at the start again when we had the accident. Ah, Brazil, yes, and South Africa tangled first, didn't they?
Yes, it was. Brazil clipped the back of South Africa, spun around. That caused the Lebanon to go out. It also drew in Australia as well. So there you can just see it was chaos. Cars bumping. That was the Lebanese car that went up in the air. Here's the rearward view, and that might well be from the New Zealand car looking at Canada.
Yeah, and it was also in the background. You could see Brazil hitting South Africa, so I did think they probably had a puck from somewhere, and it was Brazil who did it. Quite whether they had also had a push from someone, that's quite possible. It was all very bunched up there. But here you go, you've got a new winner in terms of a driver in A1GP. Michael Ammermüller, 21 years old, from Pocking in Germany. He's been a tester for the Red Bull team in the past. He's had a high-flying international career that was sort of dented this year when he broke his wrist early in the season and had to sit out much of the race season, and then came back. Didn't all come together for him, but I tell you what, as soon as he sat in this A1GP car, he looked completely at home.
Yes, he has, and I think the seat now, after today's drive in the sprint race, one can pretty much say is going to be his for the remaining part of the third series of A1GP. But there, the China fans and the team members, they are absolutely delighted. Frankie Cheng on the podium for China. And, well, the cheers that we're hearing here are actually for Frankie Cheng. The grandstand, the fans that have come all the way down to Zhuhai from Macau, from Hong Kong, plus from Zhuhai City itself, delighted with that result.
Yeah, that is very special. Look at the points now. Switzerland have extended their points lead over France. New Zealand still in third. Great Britain have popped back up to fourth, having dropped to sixth. So that's important for them. Netherlands in fifth. Ireland in sixth place. They lost out on the podium there. South Africa still in seventh place. Germany have gone from 11th to eighth. Good progress thanks to the victory. China in ninth place. So they're very useful points for them. And then further on down the order, no points today for Malaysia or Australia, both involved in that first lap incident, unfortunately. The Czech Republic able to add to their tally, though, with a strong fifth place from Thomas Enger.
So, all the congratulations from Team China to Frankie Cheng. I mean, he didn't win the race, but he's on the podium in third place. And an outstanding drive, and a really redeeming drive from Michael Ammermüller to take the victory.
So, from villain in Malaysia, it's hero this time for Michael Ammermüller of Germany. Switzerland in second place, courtesy of Neil Yarny. But it's Kung Fu Frankie Cheng who's taken a superb third for China on home turf. Ireland finished fourth ahead of the Czech Republic. Jarvis for Great Britain was sixth ahead of Naren Kartikeyan for India. France down in eighth, then the Netherlands in ninth. And New Zealand's Johnny Reid finished 10th. Italy's Eduardo Piscopo on his debut was a good 11th. 12th was the United States, then 13th for Australia. 14th for Pakistan ahead of Canada's Robert Wickens. Then in 16th place, Mexico's David Garza. Indonesia in 17th place finished ahead of those in trouble. Brazil, Portugal, South Africa, Malaysia and Lebanon all got involved in various incidents. But it was Switzerland who ended up with the fastest lap. Well, there we go. Great start to the day, and particularly for the home fans, with China taking the victory, and a hard-earned victory by making the move of the race. to get past Team Ireland and move into third. Rob Creswell on the right there, David Sears in the middle, and great delight down there for Team Germany as Michael Amemuller has taken his first win.
Yes, so one race done, one more to go, and a little bit of chat between the various people involved, key people, James Robertson for Team Switzerland engineering that car, and of course Rob Creswell for Germany representing Michael Amemuller. But of course now we're going to have the podium ceremonies, and immediately all thoughts move onwards to the feature race this afternoon, and we've really seen a potential outcome because the Swiss team have got the pace. It was just simply that they weren't able to find the opportunity to put a move on Germany. But with Germany starting back in the third row of the grid for the feature race, the door for victory is very much now open to Switzerland and Team GBR, who are starting alongside in the front row of the grid.
That's right. So it's going to be very interesting to see. Lots to look forward to with the second race, with a very different lineup on the grid to what we had for the sprint race. But the common factor, of course, Team Switzerland, who are looking very strong. And with that fastest lap that they had in that race, there's no denying the fact that Switzerland probably go in as favourites to take a victory and to add to their tally even more. But 9 wins for Germany last year. This is their first win of season 3. And what a special moment it will be after what has been a difficult start to the season for them. Christian Vitoris, who drove for them, but there's the celebrations. And Mr. Liu there, the seat holder for Team China, so enthusiastic and very much a part of this event happening at Zhuhai. He must be over the moon with the result.
Oh, I'm sure you are. I mean, just to see the response from the Chinese fans, they don't get... Well, they get international motor racing, but not a lot of international single-seater motor racing at this level here at this racetrack.
Up onto the podium they come then. Amemuller, there's Neil Jani, looking very composed and relaxed. And listen, the response for Team China, for Kong Fu Cheng, his own personal first ever podium. And that's a smile that is great to see. He always smiles anyway, but he surely that smile is going to go from ear to ear as a result of a hard-won third position. Great stuff. And we'll have to see what he can do later on today as well in the feature. And I know a number of the other teams were very impressed by his long-distance race pace, if you like, in the practice session. So you never know, he might get another one.
Well, he certainly has got the opportunity of starting a little bit further back in the third row of the grid, but anything is possible. Mum and Dad have come down from Beijing. Frankie, of course, is an only child. And a lot of family association and delight here. There you see, look at the China team. And just if you look across here in the main principal grandstand that overlooks the start finish straight, there's real pleasure in Frankie Cheng's performance.
Yeah, I'm just glancing down from our vantage point, all the marshals of course as well, and officials are clapping and cheering. It's very special, this on home turf. This is by far their best result on home turf at any of the Chinese races that we've had so far, so that really is very, very special indeed. Neil Jani picks up the silver medal with an excellent second position, and so he will be adding to his points tally with that and extending his advantage, as we saw, over Team France. But the gold medal on this occasion is going to go to Michael Amemuller, the first time he's won in A1GP. It's certainly not the first time that Germany has won, but it just goes to show what can be done with the level of experience and quality in that team.
Yes, and all the dignitaries here making their presentations. And, well, you can see there is joy. Really, principally, Germany delighted to be back on the winner's podium. It's been a bit of a drought for them. We know about China. We've been talking about the joys of China. And Switzerland, Neil Jani doing what he had to do, consolidated second place and took that fastest lap.
So now we wait for the German national anthem. Thank you. It's a fantastic international victory for Team Germany, for Michael Ammermüller. But you can almost see, John, the focus that is still there because there's a big race to come.
Yes, the feature race is going to be a more difficult race for Germany, although they're starting in the third row of the grid and by no means is that a handicap, because with those two mandatory pit stops and there's going to be a different pressure in that feature race, and it's going to be about car conservation, looking after the car, particularly the brakes. A longer race, a lot more fuel on board, a car a lot heavier. Car will alter its characteristics throughout the race. It'll be about preserving your car. Tyre's not a problem because of those two mandatory pit stops.
That's right, so that's what we'll be looking at and wondering about. I think, as you say, by the end of that race, there could be some people in brake trouble, and that could cause some place changes right in the closing stages with people making mistakes. That's what we'll be looking to. But we had an impressive place change in that race, particularly from China. Poor old Canada, of course, with New Zealand. Don't quite know whose fault that was. We didn't really see the beginning of it. But the end result was that Canada got pushed down to 15th. For the second sprint race in a row, they've had contact from another car. But as I say, couldn't really determine whose fault it was because we only picked it up in the closing stages.
Yeah, I mean, it did look like New Zealand was trying to slide under Canada. But to make an overtaking manoeuvre on this kind of circuit where you've got pretty much stop-go corners, you've got to be alongside the car, wheel to wheel, not just front to back, as appeared to me to be the case with that move in turn one.
Absolutely. Well, everybody up on the banking there hopefully had a good view of some of the fun and games that were going on. Italy only just missed out on a point, by the way. 11th place for new man Edoardo Piscopo. He should be able to see what he can do in the feature race. The other new driver was Mexico's David Garza. He actually drove well. He ended up towards the back, down in 16th place, but a good first run from him. And he was on the pace of those cars that were just ahead of him. So it does look as though Mexico have a new young driver with plenty of potential.
I think the other thing is that basically he kept out of trouble.
Yeah.
There's no point fighting at the back of the grid and literally banging into other cars. So he kept himself clean. He got a lot of race experience, which is what he didn't have in an A1 GP car. When he goes into the feature race, he's going to get a different experience. The car will be a lot heavier. It's a longer race. It's a more physical race. So it'll be all about learning. But keep your nose clean and go on and do a better job maybe next time around at Lake Taupo in New Zealand.
Yes, that's right. So we'll be looking forward to that later on. But first of all, let's catch up with our top three drivers from the sprint race here in Zhuhai. They're with Lee McKenzie.
Michael Ammermüller, Team Germany, congratulations. Your personal first win in A1 GP. A faultless race, a great start. You must be delighted.
Yeah, I'm very happy because this season I didn't have a very great season. And it's my first win this season. And I think we all did a good job. It was a good race, strong race with good car. Everything was perfect. And then we could win the race.
And what about halfway through? Neil was going pretty quickly with Team Switzerland. Did you feel under pressure?
I think I was under pressure the whole run because he was always quite close behind me, and I think I couldn't gain a lot of space between me and him, and we was always quite together. So if I would have made a mistake or something, then for sure we'll start the battle. So I had to push all the time.
It'll be a great feature race. Congratulations. Neil Jani, Team Switzerland, second fastest lap, but you still couldn't get past Germany.
Yeah, well, in the start it was quite close, but he defended really well. And then during the race, I just saw without any risks, it's not possible to get past him. So I thought I'd just go for the fast race lap and settle for second and keep him under pressure. Maybe he makes a mistake, but he didn't do.
Now, this afternoon should be a great race. Your car looks as if it's got fantastic pace. But how much will the brakes come into play this afternoon?
A lot, I think. I think at the end of the race or midway through the race, it will start that the brakes will start to go away. So it will be a tough race for everybody, but it's for everybody the same problem. So, yeah.
Neil, congratulations. Let's move on to Frankie Cheng, Team China. Frankie, this is your first ever podium for the team. In front of your home crowd, what does this day mean to you?
It's a fantastic feeling. I cannot really describe how good I feel while crossing the finishing line. Big thanks to the team and a big thanks to all the people supporting Team China. And it's great payback to them.
Now again, your car looks as if it's got a lot of pace for this afternoon. It was a fantastic overtaking move around Ireland.
Yeah, it was good. But also Adam was he's a very experienced driver, and he gave me enough space. And I saw that he was struggling with a real grip. And it was good, but sorry for him.
Well, all these fans have come all the way here to cheer for you. Turn around and give them a wave.
Thank you very much, Lee. And yeah, it's a special, special day indeed for Frankie already. This was the move, John. Let's just have another look at it.
Yes, this is the perfect overtaking maneuver. You get the drive out of the previous corner. You get alongside. As Frankie Cheng said, Adam Carroll did everything correctly. He didn't try to be aggressive and blocking. He knew that the pace of the China car was quicker than that of the Team Ireland car. And as Frankie Cheng said, he saw Ireland struggling with traction out of turn one and two, and that gave China the momentum. And that's a proper clean overtaking maneuver, and it's a joy to see two racing drivers racing in what I would call an honorable fashion.
Now, the major incident on the first lap was involving South Africa's Adrian Zaugg. We can hear from him now with Simon Hill.
Adrian, explain to us, if you will, your version of what happened in that first lap incident, please.
Well, first of all, I got a good start. I passed two or three people into the first turn. And then into turn two, I just got hit by Brazil, I think it was, and that was it.
Now, obviously, you had to come in and retire. It looked initially like you might have been able to continue. How much damage did you incur in that situation?
Well, that's what I thought. I thought it's just the front nose and the side pot. But actually, the radiator got damaged, so we lost some liquid, so we couldn't restart.
Now, obviously, you didn't really get much of a chance to get a feel for the circuit in such a short time out there. What's your thoughts on how the sprint race is going to go with regards to things like brakes and tyres? It seems to be a question a lot of drivers are asking.
Well, just like I said, I didn't really get a chance to test now in the sprint, but just from free practice knowledge, for sure will be very tough for the brakes, but everyone has the same brakes, so everyone has to cope with the same problems.
Thank you, Adrian.
You're welcome.
Well, Adrian Zaugg, a bit of a disappointing start to the day for him, but that's the way it goes when you're in that midfield group. Let's take another look at it.
Yeah, just to the left of the screen, you're going to see there the Brazil car tags, the back, and then Brazil, China, Lebanon. And, of course, that's when the back of the car, I think that was might have been Indonesia, hit the back of Malaysia. And that's what put out Alex Jung. He got clobbered on the right rear wheel, broke a suspension component. Watched, so, well, it was, in fact, the left rear hit, but then the right rode over the nose of South Africa. And I mean, there was so much action going on. I mean, statically, a car sitting there was going to be a target, and there were lots of moving targets coming down to try and get.
Yeah, tough one. Well, let's get back down to the pits. Charlie Kimball has caught up with one of those involved, Alex Jung.
Alex, can you tell me what happened on that first lap?
Well, it's what we thought would happen is Zhuhai, and the first couple of corners are really tight, and there are just cars everywhere. I think Pakistan went into the side, I mean, hit me, and I had South Africa on my right, so I was just in the middle of a sandwich and ended up with broken suspension and front wing. That was it. We couldn't continue.
That's too bad. When you came in the pits, you stopped next to South Africa. Was that a comment about the accident or something else?
No, it wasn't South Africa's fault at all. Someone had hit South Africa before I'd hit him even, so he was just a victim. But I thought he was going to go out again. So I didn't want to get in his way, but then when it was clear he wasn't going out, then I just pulled into my box.
Great. Well, hopefully you'll have better luck this afternoon.
Hope so.
Still got a smile on his face, and he's got a much better qualifying position, to be honest, for the feature race, so he's looking forward to doing something with that.
Yes, and also I think the benefit of having one race out of the way, and drivers will now appreciate that they're going to be very close in the opening lap. They all got through turn one, which I thought was going to be the problematic corner, but in fact it all occurred coming into turn four. You're coming flat out through turn three. So the speed, again, probably around about 150 miles an hour going through turn three, then hard on the brakes, and just simply too many cars trying to get into almost a bottleneck. And once there was contact, then the thing virtually shut down.
Just under 3 hours for these guys to turn the cars around and get them back out onto the grid once again for the feature race. So pressure on for some of the teams, less so for others who've had a clean run without any damage, but they're all up to it, and I'm sure there won't be any problems. Now, there are the current positions, with Switzerland leading on 74, opening up the advantage over Team France. They've got 18 points now, with New Zealand tucked in behind in third place, then Great Britain and the Netherlands, Ireland in sixth, South Africa in seventh after failing to score once again there. Germany up to eighth place, courtesy of the victory, and China in ninth. Then Brazil, Mexico, and Team India. And of course, India will be starting from third on the grid in the feature race with a huge opportunity to score useful points. It's Canada and the Czech Republic following them, then Italy, Portugal, Australia, and those failing to score yet this year's season include Indonesia, Lebanon, and Pakistan. So let's take a look back over some of the highlights of the build-up and the race itself. The sprint race here at Zhuhai, the first ever A1GP event to be held at this circuit, and it certainly had some incident as we expected. Before they all started, the drivers looked in confident frame of mind.
Yeah, but I do suspect there's a little bit of sort of concern about turn one and a little bit of tension on the pit lane because nobody had been here before to do a standing start, let alone a rolling start, and therefore that little bit of additional tension. Maybe people being overly cautious into turn one, thinking, oh, well, that wasn't too bad. We're at the races now, and this is what occurred. Contact between Brazil and South Africa, and then four, five, six cars become involved, and effectively the race wasn't red flagged. I thought we might have seen a red flag, but the corner workers did a good job getting these cars cleared very quickly. We had a safety car intervention for three laps, and then we got back underway. But it was a timed race rather than the 19 laps that we were expecting.
Yeah, great shame to see this incident, which really took out several cars. But once we got them going again, it was New Zealand and Canada involved in a big, big tussle. This was the contact. Canada managed to sneak past, but ultimately that would change towards the end of the race. James Hinchcliffe kept an eye on it. And then we saw the battle between Pakistan and Australia.
That was a good move down the inside from Adam Khan into turn seven. He got the position and he really forced Australia wide. But this is the pass, really. I think it was the outstanding maneuver of the race. Frankie Cheng for China down into turn four did a really good job. I know a big, big brave in that one. There's no doubt now, you see it, who was the guilty party in that one. There was more chance of it. Well, I'll not say it again. That was the big incident of the day. Portugal into the tyre barriers on the exit of turn 14.
Yeah, wheel over the edge. It's a classic one. Straight across to the inside and slamming into the barrier. At the end of the race, it was Germany that took the victory and the 15 points for the win, with Switzerland finishing in second, picking up 12, plus an extra one for fastest lap and further extending their lead. But China with a very notable podium finish, only their second over podium, and it the first one for that driver, Frankie Cheng. So it really does open things up for the feature race later on today. We're going to have a lot to look forward to on the long distance race, where the brake wear is a real concern.
Yes, it's going to be about conservation as much as it's going to be about pace. And those at the front will be able to control that pace. It'll be those behind who are getting caught up and are not able to drive in that fluid manner. If you're trying to conserve your car and your brakes, that will suffer most.
So Michael Amemuller takes the first race victory of the day. Can he make it two out of two? It'll be tough from fifth place on the grid, but he'll be going for it. Join us again later. Bye-bye for now.